shall we three meet again, in thunder, lightning, or in rain?
When the herd burn is done,
when the battle's lost and won, that will be ever set of sun. Where the place
upon the heath,
there to meet with Macbeth.
I come, Grimalkin,
Pericles.
Anon.
Fair is foul, and foul is fair. Hover through the fog and filthy
air. What bloody man is that? He can report, as seemeth by his plight, of the revolt the newest state. Question him, Malcolm, my son.
This is the sergeant who, like a good and hardy soldier, fought against my captivity. Hail, brave friend! Say to the king the knowledge of the broil as thou didst leave it.
Doubtful it stood. As two spent swimmers that do cling together and choke their art, the merciless MacDonald, worthy to be a rebel, for to that the multiplying villainers of nature do swarm upon him, from the western isles of Kearns and gallow glasses is supplied. And fortune, on his damned quarrels smiling, showed like a rebel's whore. But all's too weak, for brave Macbeth, well he deserves that name. Disdaining fortune, with his brandished steel, which smoked with bloody execution, like valor's minion, carved out his passage till he faced the slave, which ne'er shook hands nor bade farewell to him, till he unseamed him from the nave to the chops and fixed his head upon our battlements.
Oh, valiant cousin, worthy gentleman.
Mark, King of Scotland, mark. No sooner justice had with valor armed compelled these skipping kerns to trust their heels, but the Norwegian lord, surveying vantage, with furbished arms and new supplies of men, began a fresh assault.
Dismayed not this our captains, Macbeth and Banquo?
Yes, as sparrows, eagles, or the hare, the lion. But I am faint. My gashes cry for help.
So well thy words become thee as thy wounds. They smack of honor both. Go, get him surgeons. Who comes here?
The worthy Thane of Ross.
What a haste looks through his eyes. So should he look that seems to speak things strange.
God save the king!
Whence camest thou, worthy Thane?
From Fife, great king, where the Norwegian banners flout the sky and fan our people cold. Norway himself, with terrible numbers, assisted by that most disloyal traitor, the Thane of Cawdor, began a dismal conflict, till that Bellona's bridegroom, lapped in proof, confronted him with self-comparisons, point against point, rebellious arm against arm, curbing his lavish spirit. And to conclude, the victory fell on us.
Great happiness.
And now, Sweno, the Norway's king, craves composition. Nor would we deign him burial of his men till he disperses at St. Colm's Inch $10,000 to our general use.
No more that Thane of Cawdor shall deceive our bosom interest. Go, pronounce his present death, and with his former title, greet Macbeth.
I'll see it done.
What he hath lost, noble Macbeth hath won.
Where hast thou been, sister?
Killing swine.
Sister, where thou? A sailor's wife had chestnuts in her lap, and munched and munched and munched. Give me, quoth I, the roity which the rump-fed rumian cries. Her husband's to Aleppo gone, master of the tiger. But in a safe I'll thither sail, and like a rat without a tail, I'll do.
I'll give thee a wine.
Thou art kind.
And I another.
I myself have all the other.
A drum. Macbeth doth come.
Weird sisters hand in hand,
roosters of the sea and land,
thus do go about, thrice to thine, thrice to mine,
thrice again to make up nine.
Peace, the charm's wound up.
So foul and fair a day I have not seen.
How far is Gaul to Forres?
These, so withered and so wild in their attire, that look not like the inhabitants of the earth, and yet are aunt.
If you are you aught that man may question, you seem to understand me by each at once her choppy finger laying upon her skinny lips. You should be women, and yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you are so.
Speak if you can. What are you?
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Glamis. All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Cawdor. All hail, Macbeth, that shalt be king hereafter.
Good sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? For the name of truth, are ye fantastical, or that indeed which outwardly ye show? My noble partner, you greet with pleasant grace and great prediction of noble having and of royal hope that he seems rapt withal. To me you speak not. If you can look into the seeds of time and say which grain will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate.
Hail,
lesser than Macbeth and greater.
Not so happy, yet much happier. Thou shalt get kings though thou be none. So all hail, Macbeth and Banquo, Macbeth, all hail.
Stay, you imperfect speakers, tell me more. By Cynel's death, I know I'm Thane of Glamis, but how of Cawdor? The Thane of Cawdor lives, a prosperous gentleman, and to be king stands not within the prospect of belief, no more than to be Cawdor. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence, or why upon this blasted heath you stop our way with such prophetic greeting. Speak, I charge you.
Earth hath bubbles as the water has, and these are of them.
Whither are they vanished? Into the air. And what seemed corporal melted as breath into the wind. Would they had stayed?
Were such things here as we do speak about? Or have we eaten on the insane root that takes the reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
Thane of Cawdor, too, went it not so?
To the selfsame tune of where?
My lord!
Who's here?
The lords of Ross and Angus.
The king hath happily received, Macbeth, the news of thy success. And when he reads thy personal venture in the rebels' fight, his wonders and his praises do contend which should be thine or his. As thick as hail came post with post, and every one did bear thy praises in his kingdom's great defense, and poured them down before him.
We are sent to give thee from our royal master thanks, only to herald thee into his sight, not pay thee.
And for an earnest of a greater honor, he bade me from him call thee Thane of Cawdor. In which addition, hail, most worthy Thane, for it is thine.
What? Can the devil speak true?
The Thane of Cawdor lives. Why do you dress me in borrowed robes?
Who was the Thane lives yet, but under heavy judgment bears that life which he deserves to lose. Whether he was combined with those of Norway,
Glamis, or did lie in the Cawdor, the greatest is behind.
I know not, but treasons, capital, confessed and proved, have overthrown him.
Thanks for your pains. Do you not hope your children shall be kings? When those that gave the Thane of Cawdor to me promised no less to them.
That trusted home might yet enkindle you unto the crown besides the Thane of Cawdor.
But to strange.
And oftentimes to win us to our harm, the instruments of darkness tell us truths, win us with honest trifles to betrays in deepest consequence.
Cousins, a word, I pray you. How fares the king?
Joy and strength.
Two truths are told as happy prologues to the swelling act of the imperial theme. This supernatural soliciting cannot be ill, cannot be good. If ill, why hath it given me earnest of success, commencing in a truth? I am Thane of Cawdor. If good, why do I yield to that suggestion? Whose horrid image doth unfix my hair and make my seated heart knock at my ribs against the use of nature. Present fears are less than horrible imaginings. My thought, whose murder yet is but fantastical, shakes so my single state of man that function
is smothered in some eyes, and nothing is but what is not.
Look how our partners rest.
Chance will have me king. Why chance me, crown me without meister?
New honors come upon him like our strange garments, cleave not to their mold, but with the aid of use.
Come what come may, time and the hour runs through the roughest day.
Worthy Macbeth, do we stay upon your leisure?
Give me your favor. My dull brain was wrought with things forgotten. Think upon what hath chanced. And in more time, the interim having waited, let us speak our free hearts each to other.
Very gladly.
Till then, enough. Kind gentlemen, your pains are registered where every day I turn the leaf to read them. Let us toward the king.
Is execution done on Cawdor? Are not those in commission yet returned? Speak, Malcolm.
My liege and father, they are not yet come back. But I have spoke with one that saw him die, who did report that very frankly he confessed his treasons, implored your highness' pardon, and set forth a deep repentance. Nothing in his life became him like believing it. He died as one that had been studied in his death, to throw away the dearest thing he owed as 'twere a careless trifle.
There's no art to find the mind's construction in the face. He was a gentleman on whom I built an absolute trust.
See, my lord, Macbeth and Banquo are come.
Oh, worthiest cousin, the sin of my ingratitude even now was heavy on me. Thou art so far before that swiftest wing of recompense is slow to overtake thee. Would thou hadst less deserved, that the proportion both of thanks and payment might have been mine. Only I have left to say, more is thy due, and more than all can pay.
The service and the loyalty I owe in doing it pays itself. Your highness' part is to receive our duties, and our duties are to your throne and state children and servants, which do but what they should by doing everything safe toward your love and honor.
Welcome hither. I have begun to plant thee, and will labor to make thee full of growing. Noble Banquo, thou hast no less deserved, nor must be known no less to have done so. Let me enfold thee, and hold thee to my heart.
There, if I grow, the harvest is your own.
My plenteous joys, want and in fullness, seek to hide themselves in drops of sorrow. Sons, kinsmen, thanes, and you whose places are the nearest, know we will establish our estate upon our eldest, Malcolm, whom we name hereafter the Prince of Cumberland, which honor must not unaccompanied invest him only, but signs of nobleness like stars shall shine on all deservers.
The Prince of Cumberland! Prince of Cumberland!
Down, or else I'll leap, for in my way it lies. Stars, hide your fires. Let not light see my black and deep desires. The eye wink at the hand. Yet let that be which the eye fears when it is done to see.
From hence to Inverness, and bind us to you further, good Macbeth.
The rest is labor which is not used for you. I'll be myself the harbinger and make joyful the hearing of my wife with your approach. So humbly take my leave.
Let's after him, whose care is gone before to bid us welcome. It is a peerless kinsman.
Then it being the day of success, and I have learned by the perfectest report they have more in them than mortal knowledge. When I burned in desire to question them further, they made themselves air into which they vanished. Whilst I stood wrapped in the wonder of it, came missives from the king who all hailed me Thane of Cawdor. By which title before, these weird sisters saluted me and referred me to the coming on of time with hail, king that shalt be. This I have thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mightst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness is promised thee. Lay it to thy heart and farewell. Long is the heart, and shalt be what thou art promised. And yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great, art not without ambition, but without the illness should attend it. What thou wouldst highly, that wouldst thou holily. Wouldst not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou'st have great glams, that which cries, thus thou must do, if thou'd have it. That which rather thou dost fear to do than wishest should be done. That I may pour my spirits in thine ear and chastise with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round, which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned withal.
My lady.
What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Art mad to say it. Is not thy master with him who what so would have informed for preparation?
So please you, it is true. Our thane is coming. One of my fellows had the speed of him, who, almost dead for breath, had scarcely more than would make up his message.
Give him tending. He brings great news.
I'll see it done, good madam.
The raven himself is hoarse that croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts, unsex me here, and fill me from the crown to the toe top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood, stop up the access and passage to remorse, that no compunctious visitings of nature shake my fell purpose, nor keep peace between the effect and it. Come to my woman's breasts and take my milk for gall, you murdering ministers, wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief. Come, thick night, and pall thee in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark to cry, hold, hold.
My dearest love.
Great Glums, worthy Cawdor, greater than both by the all hail hereafter. Thy letters have transported me beyond this ignorant present, and I feel now the future in the instant.
My dearest love, Duncan comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Oh, never shall sun that morrow see. Thy face, my thane, is as a book where men may read strange matters. To beguile the time, look like the time, bear welcome in your eye, your hand, your tongue, look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent under it. He that's coming must be provided for. And you shall put this night's great business into my dispatch, which shall to all our nights and days to come give solely sovereign sway and masterdom.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear. To alter favor ever is to fear. Leave all the rest to me.
This castle hath a pleasant seat. The air nimbly and sweetly recommends itself unto our gentle senses.
This guest of summer, the temple-haunting martlet, does approve by his loved mansionry that the heaven's breath smells wooingly here. No jutty, frieze, buttress, nor coign of vantage, but this bird hath made his pendant bed and procreant cradle. Where they most breed and haunt, I have observed, the air is delicate.
See! See, our honored hostess.
My most gracious lord.
The love that follows us sometime is our trouble, which still we thank as love. Herein I teach you how you shall bid God yield us for your pains and thank us for your trouble.
All our service at every point, twice done and then done double, where poor and single business to contend against those honors deep and broad wherewith your majesty loads our house. For those of old and the late dignities heaped up to them, we rest your hermits.
Where's the Thane of Cawdor? We cost him at the heels and had a purpose to be his purveyor. But he rides well, and his great love, sharp as his spur, hath holp him to his home before us. Fair and noble hostess, we are your guest tonight.
Your servants ever have theirs, themselves, and what is theirs in comp to make their audit at your highness' pleasure, still to return your own.
Give me your hand. Conduct me to mine host. We love him highly, and shall continue our graces towards him. By your leave, hostess.
Consequence and catch with his surcease success. But this blow might be the be all and the end all here. But here upon this bank and shoal of time, we'd jump for life to come. But in these cases, we still have judgment here, that we but teach bloody instructions which being taught return to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poisoned chalice to our own lips. Here in double trust, first as I am his kinsman and his subject, strong both against the deed, then as his host, who should against his murderer shut the door, not bear the knife myself. Besides this, Duncan, as born his faculties so meek, has been so clear in his great office, his virtues will plead like angels, trumpet-tongued against the deep damnation of his taking off, and pity like a naked newborn babe, striding the blast, or heaven's cherubim, horsed upon the sightless couriers of the air, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye. The tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of my intent, but only vaulting ambition which leaps itself, fall on the other.
Anna, what news?
He hath almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Hath he asked for me?
Know you not he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. Honored me of late, and I have bought golden opinions of all sorts of people which should be worn now in their newest gloss. Not cast aside so soon.
Was the hope drunk wherein you dressed yourself? Hath it slept since, and wakes it now to look so green and pale at what it did so freely? From this time such I account thy love. Art thou afeard to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteem'st the ornament of life, and live a coward in thy own esteem, letting I dare not wait upon I would like the poor cat of the adage?
Prithee, peace. I dare do all that may become a man. Who dares do more is none.
What beast was then that made you break this enterprise to me? When you darest do it, then you were a man. And to be more than what you were, you would be so much more the man. Nor time nor place did then adhere, and yet you would make both. They have made themselves, and that their fitness now doth unmake you. I have given suck, and know how tender 'tis to love the babe that milks me. I would, while it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from his boneless gums and dashed the brains out, had I so sworn as you have done to this.
If we should fail.
We fail? What, screw your courage to the sticking place, and we'll not fail? When Duncan is asleep, whereto the rather shall his day's hard journey soundly invite him, his two chamberlains will I with wine and wassail so convince that memory, the warder of the brain, shall be a fume, and the receipt of reason a limbeck only. When in swinish sleep their drenched natures lie as in a death, what cannot you and I perform upon the unguarded Duncan? What not put upon his spongy officers? Who shall bear the guilt of our great quell?
Bring forth men, children, only, for
for thy undaunted metal should compose nothing but males. Will it not be received when we have marked with blood those sleepy two of his own chamber and used their very daggers that they have done?
Who dares receive it other as we shall make our griefs and clamor roar upon his death?
I am settled and bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away, and mock the time with fairest show. False face must hide what the false heart doth know.
How goes the night, boy?
The moon is down. I have not heard the clock.
And she goes down at 12.
I take 'tis later, father.
Hold, take my sword. There's husbandry in heaven, their candles are all out. Take thee that too. A heavy summons lies like lead upon me, and yet I would not sleep. Merciful powers restrain in me the cursed thoughts that nature gives way to in repose. Give me my sword. Who's there?
A friend, good Banquo.
What, sir, not yet at rest? The king's abed. He hath been an unusual pleasure and sent great largesse to your offices. This diamond he greets your wife withal by the name of most kind hostess and shut up in measureless content.
Being unprepared, our will became the servant to defect, which else should free have wrought.
All's well. I dreamt last night of the three weird sisters. To you they have showed some truth.
I think not of them. Yet when we can entreat an hour to serve, we would spend it in some words upon that business, if you would grant the time.
At your kindest leisure.
If you shall cleave to my consent, when 'tis, it shall make honor for you.
So I lose none in seeking to augment it, but still keep my bosom franchised and allegiance clear, I shall be counseled.
Good repose the while.
Thanks, sir. The like to you. Come, boy.
Oh, there, Seaton.
My lord.
Go bid thy mistress, when my drink is ready, she strike upon the bell. Get thee to bed.
I will, my lord.
Is this a dagger which I see before me, the handle toward my hand? Come, let me clutch thee. I have thee not, and yet I see thee still. Art thou not fatal vision, sensible to feeling as to sight? Or art thou but a dagger of the mind, a false creation proceeding from the heat-oppressed brain? I see thee yet, in form as palpable as this which now I draw. Thou marshallest me the way that I was going, and such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes are made the fools of other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee still, and on thy blade and dudgeon gouts of blood, which was not so before. There's no such thing. It is the bloody business which informs thus to mine eyes. Now o'er the one half world, nature seems dead, and wicked dreams abuse the curtain sleep. Witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offerings, and withered murder alarmed by his sentinel, the wolf, whose howls his watch, thus with his stealthy pace, with Tarquin's ravishing strides towards his design, moves like a ghost. Thou sure and firm, said Earth, hear not my steps, which way they walk, for fear thy very stones prate of my whereabout. And take the present horror from the time, which now suits with it. Whilst I threat, he lives. Words to the heat of deeds too cold.
it is a knell that summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which hath made them drunk hath made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire. Hark. It was the owl that shrieked the fatal bellman which gives the sternst good night. He is about it. The doors are open, and the surfeited grooms do mock their charge with snores. I have drugged their possets that death and nature do contend about, and whether they live or die.
Who's there? On hold!
Back, I am afeard they have awaked, and 'tis not done. The attempt and not the deed confounds us. Hark! Laid their daggers ready, could not miss him. Had he not resembled my father as he slept, I had done it. My husband.
I have done the deed. Dost thou not hear a noise?
Heard the owl scream and the crickets cry. Did not you speak?
When?
Now.
As I descended?
Aye. Hark.
I see the second chamber.
Don Upain.
This is a sorry sight.
A foolish thought to say a sorry sight.
As one did laugh in sleep and one cried murder, that they did wake each other, I stood and heard them. But they did say their prayers and addressed them again to sleep.
There are two lodged together.
One cried, God bless us, and amen, the other, as they had seen me with these hangman's hands. Listening their fear, I could not say amen when they did say, God bless us.
Consider it not so deeply.
But wherefore could I not pronounce amen? I had most need of blessing, and amen stuck in my throat.
These deeds must not be thought of after these ways. So it will make us mad.
I thought I heard a voice cry, sleep no more. Macbeth does murder, sleep the innocent sleep. Sleep that knits up the raveled sleeve of care, the death of each day's life, sore labor's bath. Balm of hurt minds, great nature's second course, chief nourisher in life's feast.
What do you mean?
Still it cried, sleep no more to all the house. Glamis hath murdered sleep, and therefore Cawdor shall sleep no more. Macbeth shall sleep no more.
Who was it that thus cried? Why, worthy thane, you do unbend your noble strength to think so brain-sickly of things. Go get some water and wash this filthy witness from your hand. Why did you bring these daggers from the place? They must lie there. Go carry them and smear the sleepy grooms with blood.
I'll go no more. I'm afraid to think what I have done. Look on again, I dare
not. Infirm of purpose, give me the daggers. The sleeping and the dead are but as pictures. 'Tis the eye of childhood that fears a painted devil. If he do bleed, I'll gild the faces of the grooms withal, for it must seem their guilt.
Whence is that knocking? Highest with me when every noise appalls me.
What hands are here? Ah, they pluck out mine eyes.
Will all great Neptune's ocean wash this blood clean from my hand?
No, this my hand will rather the multitudinous seas incarnadine, making the green one red.
My hands are of your color, but I shame to wear a heart so white. I hear a knocking at the south entry. Retire we to our chamber. A little water clears us of this deed. How easy is it then? Your constancy hath left you unattended. Hark, more knocking. Get on your nightgown, lest occasion call us and show us to be watchers. Be not lost so poorly in your thoughts.
To know my deed, 'twere best not know myself. Wake, Duncan, with thine knocking. I would thou couldst.
Here's a knocking indeed. If
a man were porter of Hillgate, he should have old turn and the key. Knock, knock, knock. Who's there in the name of Beelzebub? Oh, here's a farmer that hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Come in time, have napkins in our about you here. You'll sweat for it. Knock, knock, knock. Who's there? Faith, here's an English tailor coming there for stealing out of a French horse. Oh, come in, tailor. Here you may roast your goose. Knock, knock, never quiet. What are you? Oh, but this place is too cold for hell. I'll devil partner it no further. I had thought to have let in some of all professions that go the primrose way to the everlasting bonfire. Unknown, unknown. I pray you remember the porter.
Was it so late, friend, ere you went to bed, that you didn't lie so late?
Faith, sir, we were carousing till the second cook. And drink, sir, is a great provoker of three things.
What three things does drink especially provoke?
Marry, sir, nose painting, sleep, and urine. Literally, sir, it provokes and unprovokes. It provokes the desire, but it takes away the performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be an equivocator with lechery. It makes him and it mars him. It sets him on and it takes him off. It persuades him and disheartens him. Makes him stand to and not stand to. In conclusion, equivocates him in a sleep and giving him the lie, leaves.
I believe drink gave thee the lie last night.
Aye, that did sit at the very throat on me. But I requited him for his lie, and I think being too strong for him, though it took up my leg some time, yet I made a shift to cast him.
Is thy master stirring? Oh, knocking has awaked him. Here he comes.
Good morrow, noble sir.
Good morrow, both.
Is the king stirring, worthy thane?
Not yet.
He did command me to call timely on him. I have almost slipped the hour.
I'll bring you to him, Macduff.
I know this is a joyful trouble to you, but yet 'tis one.
The labor we delight in, physic's pain. This is the door.
I'll make so bold to call, for 'tis my limited service.
Goes the king hence today?
He does. He did appoint so, Lennox.
The night has been unruly. Where we lay, our chimneys were blown down. And as they say, lamentings heard in the air. Strange screams of death, and prophesying with accents terrible of dire combustion and confused events new hatched to the woeful time. The obscure bird clamored the livelong night. Some say the earth was feverous and did shake.
It was a rough night.
My young remembrance cannot parallel a fellow to it.
Oh, horror! 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 Tongue nor heart cannot conceive nor name thee.
What's the matter?
Confusion now hath made his masterpiece. Most sacrilegious murder hath broke ope the Lord's anointed temple and stole thence the life of the building.
What is you say? The life?
Mean you his majesty? Approach the chamber and destroy your sight with a new gorgon. Do not bid me speak. See and then speak yourselves. Away, away! Ring the alarm bell! Murder and treason! Banquo, Dolome, and Malcolm, awake! Shake off this downy sleep, death's counterfeit, and look on death itself! Malcolm Banquo!
What's the business that such a hideous trumpet calls to parley the sleepers of the house? Speak! Speak!
Oh, gentle lady, 'tis not for you to hear what I can speak. The repetition in a woman's ear would murder as it fell.
Oh, now, Macduff?
Oh, Banquo! Banquo, our royal master's murdered!
What in our house?
Too cruel anywhere. Dear Duff, I prithee contradict thyself and say it is not so.
Had I but died an hour before this chance, I had lived a blessed time. For from this instant there's nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys, renown and grace is dead. The wine of life is drawn, and the mere lease is left this vault to brag on.
Why is this clamor?
What is amiss?
You are, and do not know, the spring, the head, the fountain of your blood. It is stopped. The very source of it is stopped.
Your royal father's murdered.
By who?
Those of his chamberers, it seemed, had done it.
Their hands and faces were all badged with blood. So were their daggers, which unwiped we found upon their pillows. They stared and were distracted. No man's life was to be trusted.
Oh, yet I do repent me of my fury that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise, amazed, temperate and furious, loyal and neutral in a moment? No man. The expedition of my violent love outran the pauser reason. Here lay Duncan, his silver skin laced with his golden blood, and his gashed stabs looked like a breach in nature for ruin's wasteful entrance. There the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could refrain that had a heart to love, and in that heart, courage to make love known?
Oh, help me, Henry.
Look to the lady.
Oh.
Look to the lady. When we have our naked frailties hid that suffer in exposure, let us meet and question this most bloody piece of work to know it further. Fears and scruples shake us. In the great hand of God I stand. And thence against the undivulged pretense I fight of treasonous malice.
And so do I.
Let's briefly put on manly readiness and meet i' the hall together.
What will you do? Let's not consort with them, brother. To show an unfelt sorrow is an office which the false man does easy. How to England?
To Ireland, aye. Our separated fortunes will keep us both the safer. Where we are, Malcolm, there's daggers in men's smiles. The nearer in blood, the nearer bloody.
This murder a shaft that shot hath not yet lighted, and our safest way is to avoid the aim. Therefore to horse, and let us not be dainty of leave taking, but shift away. There's warrant in that theft which steals itself, when there's no mercy left.
Lord Ross.
Good morrow, sir.
80 I can remember well. Within the volume of which time I have seen hours dreadful and things strange. But this last night hath trifled former knowings.
Ah, good father, thou seest the heavens, as troubled with man's act, threatens his bloody stage. By the clock 'tis day, and yet dark night strangles the travelling lamp. Is night's predominance or the day's shame? That darkness does the face of earth entomb when living light should kiss it.
It is unnatural, even like the deed that's done. On Tuesday last, a falcon, towering in her pride of place, was by a mousing owl hawked at and killed.
And Duncan's horses, the thing most strange and certain, beauteous and swift, the minions of their race turned wild in nature, broke their stalls, flung out, contending against obedience, as they would make war with mankind.
'Tis said they ate each other.
They did so, to the amazement of mine eyes that looked upon it. Here comes the good Macduff. How goes the world, sir, now?
Why, see you not?
Is known who did this more than bloody deed?
Those that Macbeth hath slain.
Alas, the day, what good could they pretend?
They were suborned, Ross. Malcolm and Donald Bane, the king's two sons, were stolen away and fled, which puts upon them suspicion of the deed.
Then 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon Macbeth.
He is already named and gone to Scone to be invested.
Will you to Scone?
No, cousin. I'll to Fife.
Well, I will thither.
Well, may you see things well done there. Adieu. Lest our old ropes sit easier than our new.
Farewell, father.
God's benison go with you. And with those that would make good of bad, and friends or foes.
Thou hast it now, King Cawdor. Glamis, all, as the weird women promise. And I fear thou playedst most foully fought. Yet it was said it should not stand in thy posterity, but that myself should be the root and father of many kings. If there comes truth from them, as upon thee, Macbeth, their speeches shine, why, by the verities on thee made good, may they not be my oracles as well, and set me up in hope?
The king!
The king!
But hush no more.
The king! The king!
We thank you all. Hail to your majesty. Here's our chief guest.
If Banquo had been forgotten, it had been as a gap in our great feast and all thing unbecoming.
Tonight we hold a solemn supper, sir, and I'll request your presence. Let your highness command upon me, to the which my duties are with a most indissoluble tie forever knit. Ride you this afternoon? Aye, my good lord. We should have else desired your good advice, which still hath been both grave and prosperous in this day's council, but we'll take tomorrow. Is it far you ride?
As far, my lord, as we'll fill up the time twixt this and supper. Go not my horse the better, I must become a borrower of the night for a dark hour or twain.
Fail not our feast.
My lord, I will not.
We hear our bloody cousins are bestowed in England and in Ireland, not confessing their cruel parricide, filling their hearers with strange invention, but of that tomorrow, when wherewithal we shall have cause of state craving us jointly. Are you to horse, adieu, till you return at night? Goes Fleance with you?
Aye, my good lord. Our time does call upon us.
I wish your horses swift and sure of foot, and so I do commend you to their backs. Farewell.
Farewell, my lord.
Let every man be master of his time till 7 at night. To make society the sweeter welcome, we will keep ourselves till supper time alone. Till then, God be with you. Seaton. Attend those men our pleasure.
They are, my lord, without the palace gate.
Bring them before us.
I will, my lord.
To be thus is nothing, but to be safely thus. Our fears in Banquo stick deep, and in his royalty of nature reigns that which would be feared. 'Tis much he dares, and to that dauntless temper of his mind he hath a wisdom that doth guide his valor to act in safety. There is none but he whose being I do fear. And under him my genius is rebuked, as it is said Mark Antony's was by Caesar. It chid the sisters when first they put the name of king upon me, and bade them speak to him. Then prophet-like they hailed him father to a line of kings. Upon my head they placed a fruitless crown, and put a barren scepter in my gripe, thence to be wrenched with an unlineal hand, no son of mine succeeding. If it be so, for Banquo's issue have I filed my mind. For them, the gracious Duncan, have I murdered, put rancors in the vessel of my peace only for them, and mine eternal jewel given to the common enemy of man to make them kings. The seed of Banquo, king. Rather than so, come fate into the list and champion me to the utterance. Who's there?
The men your majesty did send to see.
As well. Now go to the door and stay there till we call. Was it not yesterday we spoke together?
Aye, my good lord.
Well then, now, have you considered of my speeches? Know that it was he in the times past which held you so under fortune, which you thought had been our innocent self. This I made good to you in our last conference, passed in probation with you, how you were born in hand, how crossed, the instruments, who wrought with them, and all things else that might to half a soul and to a notion crazed say, thus did Banquo.
You made it known to us.
I did so, and went further, which is now our point of second meeting. Are you so gospeled to pray for this good man and for his issue, whose heavy hand hath bowed you to the grave and beggared yours forever?
We are men, my liege.
Aye, the catalogue ye go for men. There's hounds and greyhounds, mongrels, spaniels, curs, shuffs, water rugs, and demi-wolves, acclept all by the name of dogs. The valued file distinguishes the swift, the slow, the subtle,
the housekeeper, the hunter, everyone according to the gift which bounteous nature hath in him closed, whereby he does receive particular addition from the bill that writes them all alike. And so of men. Now, if you have a station in the file, not in the worst rank of manhood, say it. I will put that business in your bosoms, whose execution takes your enemy off, grapples you to the heart and love of us, who wear our health but sickly in his life, which in his death were perfect.
I am one, my liege, whom the vile blows and buffets of the world have so incensed that I am reckless what I do to spite the world.
And I another, so weary with disasters, tugged with fortune, that I would set my life on any chance to mend it or be rid of it.
Both of you know Banquo was your enemy.
Aye, my lord.
So is he mine, and in such bloody distance that every minute of his being thrusts against my nearest of life. And though I could with barefaced power sweep him from my sight and bid my will avouch it, yet I must not, for certain friends that are both his and mine, whose loves I may not drop, but wail his fall, who I myself struck down, and thence it is that I to your assistance do make love, masking the business from the common eye for sundry weighty reasons.
We shall, my lord, perform what you command us.
Oh, our lives...
Your spirits shine through you. Within this hour at most, I will advise you where to plant yourselves, acquaint you with the perfect spy of the time. The moment on, for must be done tonight, and something from the palace. Always thought that I require a clearness, and with him, to leave no rubs nor botches in the work, Fleance, his son, that keeps him company, whose absence is no less material to me than is his father's, must embrace the fate of that dark hour. Resolve yourselves apart. I'll come to you anon.
I'm a good lord.
I'll call upon you straight. Abide within. It is concluded. Banquo, thy soul's flight, if it find heaven, must find it out tonight.
Banquo gone from court?
Aye, madam, but returns again tonight.
Say to the king I would attend his leisure for a few words.
Madam, I will.
Naught's have. All spent when our desire is got without content. 'Tis safer to be that which we destroy than by destruction dwell in doubtful joy. How now, my lord? Why do you keep alone? Of sorriest fancies your companions making, using those thoughts which should indeed have died with them they think on. Things without all remedy should be without regard. What's done is done.
We have scotched the snake, not killed it. She'll close and be herself whilst our poor malice remains in danger of her former tooth. But let the frame of things disjoint both the worlds suffer. There we will eat our meal in fear and sleep in the affliction of these terrible dreams that shake us nightly. Better be with the dead whom we, to gain our peace, have sent to peace than on the torture of the mind to lie in restless ecstasy. Duncan is in his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst, nor steel, nor poison. Malice, domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further.
Come on, gentle, my lord. Sleek o'er your rugged looks. Be bright and jovial amongst your guests tonight.
So shall I, love. And so, I pray, be you. Let your remembrance apply to Banquo. Present him eminence, both with eye and tongue. Unsafe the while that we must lave our honors in these flattering streams and make our faces visage to our hearts, disguising what they are.
You must leave this.
Oh, full of scorpions is my mind, dear wife.
Thou knowest that Banquo and his fleance lives.
But in them nature's copies not eterne.
There's comfort yet. They are assailable. And be thou jocund, ere the bat hath flown his cloistered flight, ere to Black Hecate summons, the shard-born beetle with his drowsy hums hath rung night's yawning peal, there shall be done a deed of dreadful note.
What's to be done?
Be innocent of the knowledge, dearest Chuck, till thou applaud the deed. Come, sealing night, scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, and with thy bloody and invisible hand, cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale.
Crow makes wing to the rookie wood. Good things of day begin to droop and rouse, whilst night's black agents to their prey do rouse. Thou marvelest at my words, but hold thee still. Things bad begun make strong themselves by ill.